Hello everybody and welcome back to our 11th webinar. Welcome to everybody from Panacea eBiz Consulting Group, inviting you to Resolve the Unresolved Forum. Today we have a very exciting and very important and pertinent topic to be discussed upon, which is funding challenges for businesses. And this is not a problem for one or two or a small or big setup. It's a pertinent and a pressing query for each and every organization, whether it is startup, growing organization, or a company which wants to diversify. In this context, it is not only about who will give me the funding, but to set the theme at the onset of this webinar, I would say is the paradigm shift the way we manage businesses. So the fund and the money has not gone anywhere. It's there. But the focus of how we run businesses and how we manage businesses can't be the practices of yesteryears. So if I ran the business 25 years, 30 years in a way, and I make my plans in the same way, a financier or a potential investor will not appreciate or look at it. And we were having a discussion around that. Today, with me, I have Mr. Ravinder Goyal and Mr. Sanjeev Banerjee. Sanjeev is our guest speaker today. Welcome, Sanjeev. Let me introduce you to both of them. Mr. Goyal, as you know, we have been participating in most of the webinars. He's an entrepreneur with 27 years of rich experience in vocational skilling. He's known as a technology entrepreneur. In fact, at present also he is mentoring and focusing on two new technology initiatives, which he is driving on his own. He has won many national and international awards because of his contribution in education and the training industry. And as we go across, I would expect Mr. Goyal to also share his experiences with respect to the topic. Mr. Sanjeev Banerjee, by profession, is a chartered accountant and he has a rich corporate experience and exposure of 20 plus years. He's an expert in corporate and known as a corporate treasury specialist. His exposure in the corporate world started off with his entry into the automobile sector with Daewoo Motors, moving on to Hyundai Motors and with Mahindra Auto. Not only that, he worked across the sector. He spent a lot of time in trading and distribution with Gohe, a German setup. He headed finance and treasury positions both in India and UAE. After spending a substantial time and efforts with the corporates within the country and outside, he decided to become an entrepreneur, which he has been successfully managing for the last 4 years under a brand name called RRBSS Business Consulting, and works extensively with MSMEs and startups and advises them in treasury restructuring, debt, equity funding. Welcome, Sanjeev, to the forum today. To start off with, Mr. Goyal, if you can share your thought process, your thoughts on the subject, please. I think your audio is muted. Your audio is muted.
Thank you, Sandeep. Hello, entrepreneurs. I welcome you all in our 11th webinar on behalf of Panacea eBiz Consulting Group's forum, Resolve the Unsolved. The forum which we have created, the name itself shows that Resolve the Unsolved. So we are trying to take, we always take feedback from the industry and try to bring up the issues which are very relevant to them, which are there with them, but those are not addressed with the regular run-of-the-mill kind of consultants of the existing manpower. So we are in our efforts, this is our 11th webinar, and our today's topic is funding challenges in business. It is one of the most crucial aspect of for any startup or for any existing business. During this COVID-19 time, surviving has become the key. Survival of the fittest is one part, but surviving without any revenue has become a key concern. And still across the world, many of the businesses are yet not operating at their full capacity. And biggest hit, I think, is the SME sector, where MSME sector, basically where funds, the capital inflow, the cash flow, everything is on a question mark as of now. And they are finding really a great challenge in managing their funds. And the whatever support is there from the government or from the private funding agencies or venture capitalists or debt funding, whatever it is, ultimately, all channels, they look for what you have, what you can do. I remember, like if we talk about 1980s or 1970s, the industrial era, right now we are into information and probably the revolution we are calling Industrial Revolution 2.0, I think. Is it, Sandeep? You are muted.
4.0,
okay. So now in this, the past, people used to boast on their land, their machinery, and the production. Today, if you go to any funding agency, they don't ask for the land and building and your probably the plant and machinery, because they all are depreciating assets and they cannot be capitalized. Now, today they look for the scalability, they look for the growth, they look for the profits. In past, the chartered accountants, I'm sorry, Sanjeev, I'm just using this word. The balance sheet used to be defined in a different perspective. Today, if you are continuing with the same old school of thoughts, going for funding becomes almost a no-no outcome. So, there are different options. You can go for debt funding, equity funding, or maybe like probably Sanjeev will be able to speak better on this. He's an expert on this subject. But yes, like whatever you think of, you need to have a detailed and realistic business plan. The biggest challenge I see when we talk with the entrepreneurs and the startup guys, they are all in a flimsy feeling that yes, my business is good and I'm doing very good. But they don't have a realistic business plan where they can talk about their future. They do not have the detailed HR planning. They don't have detailed planning for cash flows, or they don't have planning for like sudden crisis. Like nobody planned in the like best of the best companies. They were having no plan for COVID kind of pandemic, which really closed down the businesses across. So we don't have a proper planning. We don't have a planning for next 5 years. We don't have a realistic plan that if something goes wrong, what will happen. But today the investor or the bank or any financing or funding agency, they really work very deeply into your components of balance sheet or the project, what you prepare. The next challenge I feel is that the business people or the entrepreneurs, they don't value their business accurately. Mostly, they do not analyze the cash flow or a market comparison with other businesses. The ego of it is my product and it is the best product I have probably may not find a suitable response from the funding agency. So you need to go with the market. Probably I'll take a small comparison. If you are doing good in a sector and you are at a turnover of X, and your competitors are doing a turnover of 100x. Now, if you value your company, definitely from other perspective, it will not be valued at the same level where the 100x company is operating. So how you can compare and take larger funds that entirely depends on your proposition, the way you propose to the funding agency. And ultimately, it is the honesty and business understanding what has been ignored mostly in excitement of going for funding. So probably I'll welcome Sanjeev Banerjee, who's a renowned corporate treasury specialist. And I request all of you to put forward your queries in our chat box. We will try to answer the queries, whatever is there, post Sanjeev's session is over. I thank you all for listening to me, and back to Sandeep to take this further now. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Goyal. Welcome, Sanjeev, once again.
Thank you.
Please take it on from here. We'll join you in the process.
So thank you. Good evening to you all. First and foremost is that, the context is already set, that we have a challenge in front of us, whether the challenge is the funding or our own process that we have to learn through this webinar. This is my endeavor. And I can tell you that this is the gist of my 20 plus years of my experience in the corporate, different multinational big corporate, that this is where probably it's not the SME or MSME or the medium enterprise is suffering. It's all across where the people are suffering, the businesses are suffering. With that, let's start off the webinar. So we'll talk about the funding challenges in the business now. So the area that I'm going to cover is, what is funding? Probably all of us know what is funding. Let's try to understand the dictionary word and try to link it up with the businesses. What is optimum funding? Challenges from the customer perspective, challenges from the financial institute perspective, very important to understand, and how we can resolve them. What is the action points? So with this, let's start off. What is funding? Very basic question. So this is something, most of us must be knowing, but still I thought of giving the perspective. Funding is the money given by government, financial institution, which means banks, for an event or activity to a business, organization, or individual. So the funding is given for an event or activity, and we have to confine our activity to this activity, what we have declared to the funding institution. This is a very important aspect. Then the funding can be done by ownership or the external entities. External entity ownership means what the entrepreneur brings or the family from the entrepreneur brings to the business. And the external entities mean the financial institutions and the banks. Okay. And what is the, how the funds can be available and how we can optimize that. That will make all the differences. So, then what is optimum funding all about? We may be talking about adequate funding, optimum funding, but what is meaning by optimum funding? Optimum funding of a business is the business mix of equity and debt to maximize the company's market value and minimize the cost of capital. So if you see the funding optimization will happen when there is a proper mix between the equity and the debt in the business. What we're going to throw where I can have maximum market value means I have the potential to grow, where I have potential to earn high and potential to reach, that is the market value, and minimal cost of capital. Obviously, that's everybody's talk of the town. Now, and what does it mean? Underutilization means it lead to higher cost of funding. If you have 10 crore of funding available, out of which you are not able to utilize that fund to that portion, then it's going to be a cost to you. Basically, if you have a term loan, if your machinery are not used to the full, so it has a cost implication to it because the cost is not getting absorbed in the entire thing. And the same way, if there is a shortage of fund, then it lead to not optimized using of the business operation, means you will be always having constraint of growth, constraint of production, constraint of reach, constraint of profitability. Because when there is shortage of fund, you try to find means and means to do it. So I talk about something which I learned when I was relatively very new into the treasury world. One of my gurus of the treasury world talked about one thing, that Sanjeev always treat the funding in the business like your blood in your body. Now, if I see from that aspect, I always give my, input to the businesses like that. If you have anemia, then you will not going to survive. And if you have excess blood in your body, then the blood is going to come from all sides of the body. And both these things are bad for your own health. So business is your own health, always have to see from that angle. So like blood, which is very, very important aspect of our body for operations. This fund is like the same. So that, we should not talk about that this operation is a good, this operation, all the operations are very important. The finance thing is the core of that. It will going to fuel everything. So from that aspect, the financial institution always stress on one very basic thing. What is the debt equity ratio? So the debt equity ratio is a mixture of debt and equity in a business, because debt and the equity, debt means I'm talking about long-term debt, like the term loans and the other aspects. And equity means the money brought in by the owners to the business along with the accumulated profit. So this is a very critical point that we need to understand. And as we progress, we are going to see that this debt equity is making the all the differences in the businesses. So straight away we come to the everybody is able to hear?
Yes, everybody is able to hear. I think somebody's microphone is on. If you can just mute it. Yes, thank you. Please.
So we come to a very important that what is the current challenges, in the funding from the customer point of view. Let's understand for the customer. Most of the entrepreneurs knows this, but I reiterate to reach to a point. Okay, so as Mr. Goyal talked about, this is a pandemic, and most of the businesses experience drop in revenue and profit, which we is a no-brainer, and we all experience in last 6-7 months that this is the trend where the businesses, the revenues have dropped and profits have also dropped. But it has certain other things that also come in. Pandemic reduced the property valuation. At some places, we have seen 10, 20, 30% reduction in the valuation. Basically, because Mr. Goyal talked about, that the businesses are not able to sustain themselves. So either they left the businesses or something. There is a higher supply of property. So there is a decrease in the value of the property. Second, very important, economic uncertainty and delayed cash flow has challenged sustainable business growth and put into high risk. So if we really see, the entrepreneurs have really faced one of the very challenge in terms of the cash flows, the payments, especially from the different sector, from the large corporates or from the government sector or from other aspect, there has been a delayed cash flow. Now, delayed cash flow has an impact on your profitability because interest is eating it up. So now that has really challenged. First, it restricts your businesses because the cycle, the working capital cycle is get disturbed. Secondly, with this kind of situation, the businesses has put them into high risk of their, how to carry forward the thing. So the growth, the sustaining of the growth has been challenged. Rather, we are not able to grow at all. And this is also linked to our high risk of, you know, with sustainability in our own businesses. So what is that we need to do right now? So we need to look at the product portfolio and the processes for our sustainability right now. Is that, you know, what Mr. Goyal and Sandeep talked about in the beginning, that what the businesses were doing 10 years, 20 years back, I would say even 5 years back, what you are doing is not currently, is no more applicable or need to be modified right now. Because there is a product has completely changed, or the processes need to be redefined so that we can sustain in our own businesses and bring growth to the businesses. Because unless until we grow, you know, we will not able to see the value of the business growing up. So why we are doing businesses, that we need to understand. To earn profits, to earn the growth in our own businesses. That is most important aspect. Why we are doing businesses. If we are continue to be, you know, some kind of stagnation, then probably we are not growing at all. And with the normal inflation in the market and the other economic factors, we start losing it out. So this is the time post-pandemic, especially if stress on the product and the processes, that we need to really work it out. Now, this is the story of one side of the customer. Now, I'm from the banking side. I try to share the challenges that we are seeing from the financial market. Now, the banks who primarily into the lendings, they post this pandemic have seen a lot of debacle in the norms that they set up over the years, though they go on modifying those appraisal. But post-pandemic, they have, because nobody has experienced pandemic before, you know, at least the entrepreneurs as of now. So the banks have really come up with a new set of parameters. What are those? Which has really hit our businesses from the debt perspective. One is mandatory positive net worth and PAT, profit after tax, for last 2 years. Now, you know, what exactly is happening? Why I started with the definition for the specific event and specific work that for that funding has come. There is a lot of businesses I have seen over the last 4 years where we have seen that a lot of drawings are happening from the businesses, and which deplete the equity or the net worth of the business. Net worth means nothing but the equity, which is the cash bringing plus the accumulated profit, less of drawings. Now, if you are earning, say, 1 crore rupees, and if you're withdrawing, say, 1.5 crore rupees, so you're depleting your capital by 50 lakhs or something like that. So if this continued, and you are not in the net worth positive situation and the PAT, so the bank is straight away rejecting the credit appraisals, you know, credit submission that you are giving. This has become a mandatory. Probably if I talking about a year back, it was not such important aspect. You know, the businesses, they used to see the businesses and all, but they have come into a very category. This is a starting point for anything. Secondly, one of the things that has really happened over last 2 years is the decline of the NBFC's operations. What we have seen over the year, that along with the banks, you know, the NBFCs played a major role in last 10, 12 years to really fund the businesses, you know, who are not up to the, the funding from the bank and other side. So NBFCs have come forward, maybe slightly higher interest. They have lent the businesses with their own controls. Now, from September 2018 onwards, we have seen there has been a sizable reduction in the NBFC's operations post debacle and all these things. So that has really impacted the NBFC's businesses in India, and that has really put a some kind of a break in funding to the businesses from that sector. And side by side, banks also became very stringent, because you know, at times they used to take a sales call or something like that. But today, the bank has really not taking if something is not right as per their own parameters. So NBFC's role is slowly and slowly is getting out of the contention for us. Then bank is also now looking at lower debt equity ratio. You know, predominantly the, you know, from the economic books and all these things, we used to talk about 2:1 ratio debt is very, very healthy. 2:1 ratio means if I have say 30 crores of funding in my businesses, 20 crores been funded by debt and 10 crore by equity. So 20 upon 10, this 2 ratio is considered very, very good. Now with the current situations and all these things, the banks are looking at a lower debt equity ratio. That means the owner's stake should be higher. You know, they are okay with 1/3 earlier. Now they are asking for say 40%, 45%. At times, if the industry is at high risk at 50% level, that means whatever the equity that you have, we will fund you up to that portion, which is a very, very, you know, tough situation for the businesses. But this is slowly and slowly, the banks are building it up to that extent. Then another challenge that we have seen over last 1-2 years is a merger of the government banks. And especially from April 2020, huge nationalized or the public sector bank get into mergers things, where earlier we have seen one bank taking over other bank in the public sector or in private sector banks. But what exactly is happening in the government sector also, there has been 3 or 4 banks is come under one umbrella of a major bank. Now with this, what exactly happened? There is a time where there is that required a synchronization, because different banks, like in PNB, has different from you know, the bank like United Bank or UK Bank or something like that. So they are working with their own parameters. Now they have to merge with PNB to formulate one kind of a thing, which is really delaying the process. And this is not just constrained to the government banks. We have seen earlier also where there has been the banks in the private sector which got merged. Now recent, if you're talking about one of the NBFCs, Clicks is really taking over Karur Vyasa Bank. You know, there is something going on, and there is a very, very strong rumors are going in the market where we have seen that maybe Kotak is taking over the IndusInd Bank, which is there in the cards also. Something is going on. Now, what exactly from the outside, we can say, oh, one bank has taken over the other bank. But please understand that, you know, like it's a transition of one bank to the other bank, you know. So the transition is required and it takes time, and that is impacting the credit appraisal process, where probably in one of the banks you are in the, which is going for a merger, is getting into a merge with another bank, and your sanction letter get delayed due to that reason. And this is at least I can vouch, one of a customer of mine has happened, and it will now take some time till the operation get synchronized and they get funded. So these are the challenges what we have really seen over these years, over this almost a year, especially last 7-8 months, that this is the new norms which has really come to the businesses. Now, another point which I just discussed, that loan to value, the LTV, has impacted the loan, because what we have seen, there has been reduction in the property valuations. So the businesses are really, you know, either have to further furnish the new credit or have to work on a reduced sort of a thing. And many of the bank have start bringing and promoting products like DOD, which is dropline OD, where every year there will be reduction of 10% of the limit or the OD limits. And in 10 years time, the entire, you know, the OD will go off, you know, sort of a thing. So the banks are playing very, very safe from the all the aspect. If you're talking about in this negative, you know, business cycle, they expect the positive PAT, you know, and work on that. Now, one thing that here I just want to mention, which Mr. Goyal has really put forward, and with due respect to my own community, there has been, you know, earlier the financials are being really made on the basis of taxes, you know, where the entrepreneur doesn't want to pay the direct taxes, especially income tax and all these things. So that has a very deep, you know, impact on your funding capabilities, because the funding is always dependent on your paying capacity. It is not security is one aspect that, okay, the asset is or the loan is secured, but the businesses, the bank is always look whether are you in a position to pay off, whether the money that the bank will going to give for the operation hike or something, whether that will be, you know, that the business has the capacity to pay or not. And the most and most important aspect, they always value with their audited prior financials. That means that whatever audited financials I have provided, that became my base for my loan determination. And I have seen that the many other businesses I have come across and all these things, they are talking about very healthy gross margin ratio, gross margin percentage. You know, when it come down to the net profit ratios or something like that, it's really, really very meager sort of a thing. When I ask that you got such a high admin SG&A expenses, sales and administrative expenses, they talk, no, I don't have much. Only what I was asked to sign, I have signed it off. Now that really put break. It's a time for us to really expand our businesses, where I have to put forward the actual position to the business, to the banks, and look for a equity participation, because the starting point for any equity participation is also your own financials. So the truth of the financials has to come in the audited financials, so that it really increases the aspect of the funding options to you. Now we have seen the challenges both from the businesses side and from the banking side. Now every problem has a resolution. So I just listed some of the resolution that we can offer, and probably during the debate, we can have further resolution coming up. So what is the basic thing that we need to now look into in the businesses? Now, one of the important aspect on realigning our target consumer value proposition and the business model for need finding mindset. Now here, I want to give you one of the experiences that I heard in my days in the automobile industry. Now what exactly happened? If you remember, Ford Motor is the first sort of a automobile company that has come in the sector. Now when Mr. Ford was thinking of making something, so he went to different sets of consumer. And those days, you know, the transportation used to happen in horses. Now from A to B, it probably it takes 2 hours to reach. So all the consumer asked that, can you make a faster horse, you know? So faster horse, so that probably I can reach this distance from A to B instead of 2 hours, maybe 1.5 hours. Now, during this time, what Mr. Ford thought of that, you know, he can't produce a horse which will going to, you know, really run faster and probably reduce 25% of the time or something like that. So he thought of something that I have to bring something, some new solution, you know, this solution which can change the perspective of the consumer. And mind it, consumer doesn't know that some kind of, you know, machinery will going to come which will make the tires move and we will reach the time in 1/4 time. So with that mind, Mr. Ford has really developed the first sort of a vehicle which took the consumer from A to B point in 1/2 hour times, which is the earlier 2 hours time. Now the point here that I want to make it out, that target consumer doesn't know their own needs actually. They got a very vague need that I need to reach slightly faster. Now what outcome has come in is that 1/4 of the time the same activity is completed. So that's the mindset thing that we need to come to the business where we not only understand our consumer, because consumer may not understand what is their own requirement, but through our solution, it is going to enrich the target customer and the customer became our own. Second, which is very, very important today's businesses, is that validate the adequate business processor for effective feasibility and delivery of the customer engagement. Now, here, I want to put it, validate the adequate business processes. Now, we all know in our experience, what is SWOT analysis? We all know, you know, what is our strength, what is our weaknesses, what is the opportunity, what are the threat in the businesses. We used to do in so many years now to understand. And everybody, whether it's a equity funding or a debt funding that we do, they all used to validate this. But today, the businesses are no more validated on the basis of the SWOT analysis. This is the latest development, which is really, and it now became very, very important to really understand the new term, PESTLE, P-E-S-T-L-E. Now, what does it mean? So it talks about P stand for political, E stand for economic, S stand for social, T terms for technology, L comes for legal, and E comes for environment. Now the PESTLE makes all the value proposition or the effectiveness of your business propositions now. It's no more that sort that I have this. No. What is the political situation? What is the economic situation? What is the, you know, what is the social, you know, if you talk about Google, you know, Google probably has more than 2.5 billion users, and every month they are adding few millions, you know, but which is offered to everybody. But out of which, what is the paying customer for them? Probably less than 4 million or slightly around 4 million. So just think of where is 2 billion more than 2 billion users, out of which only a small percentage is his own customer who is paying. The customer became a customer who is became paying customer. That is, I am focusing. Okay, so if you see from that angle, this is how the social has really impacted technology. We have seen that, you know, everything is on the tech, where there is been it ensures the scalability is not an issue for anymore. Technology has that capacity. Obviously, legal form, you know, legal aspect of the business, and we are have to keep a very, very check on the legality of each and every thing, because we are fast changing every aspect, whether it comes to GST, whether it comes to other taxation point, or the businesses impacting your own businesses from the different code verdicts and all these things. And last is the environment in and around your businesses. So this PESTLE is really a new buzzword for all of us. And very important is delivery of the customer engagement. Now, the customer engagement earlier is quite different from today's, you know. Today, the buzzwords of the industry is talk about is usefulness before usability is a new buzzword of the thing. That means usefulness before usability. So if you see, especially if you are consuming on online something, online site or something, they give you free for a month. They just give you free for a month, whether it's LinkedIn, whether it's some other thing, so that you can experience the product, experience the services they offer. After that one month, they ask you to become subscribed and the revenue started. You talk about LinkedIn, you talk about Google Suite or something. They all give you 1 month free in the beginning so that you can experience. So the delivery has now became a customer engagement now. So I first delivered, then I engaged the customer into that portfolio. That is very, very new aspect of the business that we have to look into. Then what wonder the people can do, it's nothing, it's uncomparable. So people's optimization is the very important aspect of the business as of now. And encouraging entrepreneur mindset by appropriate performance-linked cost. Now, here I want to talk about a very important aspect where, you know, we are generally having a very fixed cost linked approach towards our people working with us, you know. At the end of the month on 30th, I need to pay, say, 10,000, 20,000, 50,000, whatever, a lakh rupees of salary to that employee, irrespective of his performance and all these things. If he is underperforming, okay, let me give him some kind of a, you know, stick rule to work on you to improve and all these things. But today, the industry has to move on the automation side. Means what? The people has to really work. They really have to earn their own salary out of the businesses. Means that I need to really focus on the performance linked bonuses and the salary that you earn this, you earn the salary of this level if you are working and achieving this kind of targets on month to month basis. Probably we must be working on the sales target on this, but each and every employees' performance KPI can be monitored probably on a daily basis. Now the system can be worked out on that basis, but obviously on a weekly basis, half monthly basis or a monthly basis is quite a doable, and the salary can be linked with that mind. And that is one of the major component of the growth in the business, because people make or break the businesses. So if I am really, really, stick to the businesses, then I will going to have the cost. Now, I remember a few days back, me and my brother was talking to one of the entrepreneur, and he is running the business for last around nine odd years. Now he want to scale up the business to different level. And he talks a very important aspect that entrepreneur says that, I start with the business with those people, and those people are still there. And they are now, earlier they may be sales manager, today he's heading the sales. I got a small team, now that has grown, but they are continue to be the first layer of the business. That itself is a highly, highly motivating factor for the business employees to perform as if they are the owners and they have to carry on like this. So we need to really have to think from that. And the last of the options before I discuss a very vital point, I want to put it, mitigation of the potential risk by optimizing sweating and ownership of the asset. Now I want to talk about something about optimizing sweating. Now
Sanjeev, I request you to slightly speed up because
This is my last slide. This is
my last. Or I'll just remind you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandeep. Now, what is sweating today? It talks about that what is my operated different ratios in the businesses. What does it mean? What is my solvency ratio, which is debt equity ratio? What is my efficiency ratio? That means how much my asset is earning from me, or how much my asset is using as of now in terms of the many of us must be knowing that the inventory turnover ratio, the debtors turnover ratio, then work capital turnover ratio and other. Then the third is the profitability ratio, which is the GP ratio, net profit ratio, IPTA, and all these things having a very important aspect. And another important aspect that I as a bank want to put it, coverage ratio, interest coverage ratio, or the debt service coverage ratio on which the businesses has to do it. Now here, the one of the very important aspect, the other day I was discussing with Sandeep also, that the entrepreneur has to mitigate their risk, has to reduce the risk. And I have to really have to use it to the best so that I get back the asset back in time, or I don't own asset. Own asset means I can have a lot of other options like leasing, where I'm mitigating the risk of of my asset. You know, if my business is not doing well, I can return back those assets. Now we may be hearing many things about the leasing of cars or something, but today the asset leasing is a very important aspect. So what we try to achieve with this resolution is very important aspect of getting funded. Now funding, I talked about what is the funding difficulties in the financial institution, but there has been other aspect which is like equity funding, which is primarily, you know, bringing the equity partner to the business. It brings a lot of new value to the business. One, it enriches the business processes in terms of the new entrepreneur bring new blood to the thoughts and the money. Secondly, my cost in terms of my debt, which I need to pay off, I don't have to pay off. So my the funding requirement is done, and I'm maintaining the profitability, and I can scale it up. So what in this time we need to really look at the equity point of view, and really redefine our processes. That is most important. That validation of the business process and the business model, and how I'm getting my consumer into the engagement mode. That is the prime as of now to really resolve this funding equation. It's not about just to get the funding done from the agencies or from this. I need to really validate within my own life. You know, the other day, you know, one of the people talked to me that I use the specs. Now, if I'm not able to see the spec after wearing the spec, the problem is something different. You know, that means I need to change my specs, not the things that I am not able to see. You know, the point is that we have to relook on ourselves now, rather than really look outside and all these processes. So with this, you know, we can evaluate and evolve to a better businesses in our times. So this is what, you know, I can think from my perspective as a treasury person, that is all about you looking into their own businesses. Now I hand over to Sandeep. Thank you for listening to me. I will hand over to Sandeep to take it forward.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Thank you. It was quite informative. And in fact, I think what you propose and what we are seeing all across is transition, right?
Yeah.
And I think we already have a query. I will just read it out for you.
Yeah.
in debt financing, as a businessman, you have a control, while in equity financing, you lose your control to business. So as an entrepreneur, how you should find out to go for which type of funding for your business? Very interesting, and been asked by nearly every single entrepreneur. Thanks for the question. Please, Sanjeev.
What I always say, ek se bhale do, you know, I belong from that fraternity. I don't come from a fraternity which talks about that if I bring another partner and I will lose a lot of things. This is not that way, you know. Always brings a bigger perspective to the businesses, you know. I have seen a lot of equity participation and how exponentially those businesses has grown up. Because please understand that it is the interest of the equity person also to see his money grow.
Right.
So it is very, very important that he comes with a mind, not to just, you know, share the information of the business to the outside world. That due diligence you need to do. But the main perspective, we are not coming from other aspect, but the partner who are coming to the businesses are bringing a qualitative aspect to the business. That is most important aspect that we need to understand based on our control. The equity participation can be from the financing point of view or from the strategic point of view. So probably you need to decide whether I have to bring an equity partner as a financial partner, where I will going to deliver some kind of, a value addition when he try to exit in 3 or 5 years terms, or I will take him along with my journey. That you need to decide and bring to the table.
So this is a very pertinent question, and we have faced this and discussed this with most of the entrepreneurs on and off. Good, thanks for the query. Mr. Goyal, I think Sanjeev brought in a lot of relevant points, and what I was pondering about, though I had to just push him a bit because we have the time, some people, it's talking about transition. And I think in the last couple of days, between me and Sanjeev, between you and me, yesterday evening also, we were talking about corporates, and transition seems to be sometimes a challenge. So you have been an entrepreneur, so I wanted your thought process in light of Sanjeev shared with us. Please, Mr. Goyal.
In this entire, my 27 plus experience, 27 years of experience working with like a small time business people as my franchisee owners across India, with 687 locations, and talking to various partners across.
Right.
When we start our business, we have some perception in mind, and as we grow down the line, sometimes it happens that the perceptions are engraved and we don't look at them. We change our visions, we change our targets, we change our goals, the manpower which we started with, they leave in between, the infrastructure changed, industry changed, probably the new people have come, new entrants disrupt the entire model even. But because of individual behaviors and egos, we stick to what we started with. So the transition, what we are talking about, I think it is more of I must call it an adaptation to the newer environments of the newer domains, rather than changing anything else. So it is the person who is behind the show. Again, most of the answers I related to the person, not to the system, because the system does not stop you from getting anything, whatever you want. But for that, you have to be adaptive in nature. And you must look at that, yes, what you are thinking may not be fit in the system at all. So probably you have to align your business, your mindset, your people, or maybe your product, sometime even the pricing, the value for money, various aspects like which you can talk in length and breadth. So I feel the transition, when we talk about it, is not only about the processes or it is not about the system. It is a transition has to happen at the end of the entrepreneur himself to change his mindset and his behavior, and probably unlearn more than learning newer things. He has to unlearn the things which with which he has started, I think.
Right. See, unlearning is a major challenge always. And that is why most of the time the younger entrepreneurs are taking a lead. As I was sharing with some of you, I saw it happening in the last 6 months with two of my clients without naming. One is in technology, provided a solution to a public sector, and we were there. And surprisingly, to keep it short, they defeated global clients like Siemens and Honeywell straight on. So it's decision for who wants to change. and they are growing, and they have already applied for equity infusion of more than 20 million by using technology. So as you rightly put it, it's typically in the mindset, opportunities are there. It's for me whether I want to change or not. If I don't do it, somebody else will do it.
Correct.
I just had a line in my trainings when we used to training partners across and the people. I used to always quote one line: it is difficult for elephant to move, but a new baby, new horse, or maybe a small person can move very fast. So the turnaround time for a new startup is very less, whereas the industry or maybe a setup, a big corporate house, the turnaround time is very high. When the bureaucratic controls, the infrastructure, everything getting changed is also not very easy.
Right. Do we have anybody who has any queries? You can unmute and speak, or you can type. Sanjeev, do you want to add anything at this juncture?
I think Mr. Goel talked about, it's all about, bringing the equity is the shift in the mindset, where I need to dilute not only the my stake, my thoughts, and try to learn from the new approaches which is available to me. The point is that today the corporates or the big giants of the industry, they do a fixed sort of a training to upgrade the people, upgrade the systems. That is very important, to be in the contemporary. That is most important. I can't be live in 2017 and do a business in 2020. That era has gone now. We need to change, because everybody is changing, and pandemic has really touched that. You can't be sitting on that. You make innovations within your own processes and the systems and products to make yourself grow and sustain yourself. That is most important, I think, as of date. Maybe from the treasury guy is slightly different, but over the years, I have stood that why the businesses have fallen, not due to the funding issues, because of the process in the system that they follow. is that really? Maybe the business, and they talk about mere paas paise nahi hai, yeah, I'm restraining my growth for that reason. But actual reasons come from the people itself. What is my learning of all these 20 plus years? Thank you.
True. And in fact, as we travel from one webinar to other, we have been getting queries from certain entrepreneurs in terms of transition also, in terms of how to do it, how to go about it. So I'm sure as we keep on interacting, we'll be able to add values. And most of us, as I know, as we work with the MSME or the corporates, we are all working on transition. That is for sure.
Yeah.
And that is what is keeping the entities alive and all of us moving and running. Thank you, everybody, for participating. Thank you, Sanjeev, for sharing your thoughts and views with us. Thank you, Mr. Goel. And see you all back again next week, same time, for another session and another webinar. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjeev.
Thank you, Mr. Goel.
Okay. Bye, everybody.
Bye.